Well, thank you all for letting me be here today, for inviting me to be here. I'm gonna stand because I'm a kind of a nervous talker walker. So, Gilda's, I appreciate the opportunity to be here and to tell you a little bit about Gilda's Club. And as we were, I'm sorry, your name?
Kathy.
Kathy. Kathy and I were just chatting on the way when we were setting up, and she said, you know, it's really surprising how many people know, how few people know about, you know, who Gilda was, what we do at Gilda's Club, and why really we exist. And so I do appreciate this opportunity to come in, share a little bit about what we do, and who we are, and who we work with. So just to begin with, Gilda's Club Madison is an affiliate of the Cancer Support Community. What we do is to ensure that all people who are impacted by cancer, any cancer, are empowered by knowledge, strengthened by action, and sustained by community. And not only people with a cancer diagnosis, but also their families and friends. So if you have a sister or, you know, a sibling or a parent or a son or daughter who has a diagnosis, we also work with you to help you in processing that challenge of, gosh, what can I do to be of help, and really understanding that that space between what you can do and what you want to be able to do, and to help people sort of manage those emotional pieces. Those are very important. So let me tell you a little bit about Gilda. That's Gilda. And that's her little dog, Sparkle. And Sparkle was her, Sparkle actually went to the hospital with her. They smuggled her into the hospital when she was staying, which I think is kind of fun. So when Gilda was diagnosed with cancer, she was about 42. And she was diagnosed with ovarian cancer and really struggled. She had a lot of very unfortunate mishaps with her treatment and surgeries that didn't go well and things like that. And she had a very aggressive cancer. And while she was in, when she was in California, she attended a place called the Wellness Community. And the Wellness Community is an organization that is the other half now of the Cancer Support Community. Gilda's Club National and the Wellness Community merged in 2009, which you see down there, and became the Cancer Support Community. So she went to the Wellness Community, worked with a fantastic psychologist there, her name is Joanna Bull, and it really helped her to put things into perspective and helped her gain that strength that she was lacking when she was sitting by herself at home and worrying about everything, because uncontrolled energy can be pretty powerful and negative when you're sitting and worrying about something like a cancer diagnosis. So she went to the Wellness Community, worked with those folks, found it to be great and super helpful. And when she went back east, there was nothing like that. So what ended up happening was she actually started doing programs, bringing cancer survivors together in her own home, actually like right into her living room. She had the opportunity to bring Joanna with her, which not everybody, you don't just get to take your psychologist with you, right? Yeah. We all should be so lucky. Just want to, travel with my counselor. So she started doing programs in her home, right in her living room. And when she died, her psychologist, Joanna, and her husband and some friends of hers decided that they really had to have something like this on the East Coast. So they, in 1995, opened Gilda's Club, New York. And in 2005, some very wise people in Madison decided we really needed to have one here. Actually, I think it was 2003 when everything kind of got started. It took them 8 years to raise the money and build the clubhouse, which we now have in Middleton. It's just straight over, actually. And we have been open since then. I'll have a little bit of information a little bit later about some of the growth that we've experienced, but it's been sort of our space has been busier and busier and busier every year, and we're very, very excited about being able to serve the community. And the community that we serve, even though it says Builders Club Madison, the community that we serve is all of southwestern Wisconsin, as far east as Jefferson County, all the way over to Grant County, and up to Juneau. So if you're, you know, you go into, like, go to Dubuque and sort of do a swipe like that, it's all that area. And then in 2009, the Cancer Support Community was created, and Builders Club Madison is a part of that larger organization. So that's a little bit of our history. Questions on that? Okay. All right, I'm actually going to skip that.
What year did she die?
Oh, that's a really good question. Well, 92, maybe?
Okay.
Yeah. So why do people come to a place like Builders Club? You know, one of the things that sort of happens with just about any cancer diagnosis, and any, you know, and that of a family member, is you kind of lose that grasp on this hopeful life that you have. And you recognize that many, many, many things are out of control. And a lot of folks will isolate. And all three of those things, when you wrap them together, creates a huge impact on your immune system. It makes it a lot more difficult for you to stay, you know, at least hopeful that things will get better. Sometimes we, you know, we do funny things when we're left to our own devices. And this is true of people, you know, and I hear it all the time in our support groups, you know. I'm here because I need a place to talk about what's going on with me that is different than the support that I get from my family, my spouse, my coworkers, my friends, because they're in a different space. And I also hear it from spouses saying, wow, I really need a place to, like, kind of let go of everything that's going on. I work so hard to stay supportive, and sometimes I'm just frustrated and angry, and I don't know what to do, and I'm worried about what's going to happen if this doesn't turn out well. So, you know, this is an opportunity. Builders Club is an opportunity for people to come and share those feelings, where you don't have to burden, you know, you don't have to be worried about, gosh, you know what, if I share this with you, how are you going to feel? Because right now you're really making me mad. and I don't want to be mad at you because you're sick, and I don't want to, but I also need to be able to have that space where I can just say, wow, this is, you know, this is infuriating. I'm mad at the universe. And, you know, people do have, in a lot of the cancer clinics, will have psychologists and support groups and things like that. But what makes us a little bit different is that all of our services are available to people for free. We do not charge for anything we do. In addition to our support groups, we also have a number of classes and ways that people can take some responsibility for themselves, which even just doing that helps them to feel a little bit better. Okay, I have a little bit of control over whether or not I go to a guided imagery class, whether or not I do a yoga class. The thing that I'm doing to help me, a lot of folks right now are doing needlepoint, knitting as a bit of a meditation process, you know? Okay, or practice. I can't do a whole lot about a whole lot of things, but I can do something about this right now, and so here I am. But, you know, we provide all these services for free. Our clubhouse is a super comfortable space where people can just sort of come and be. People can come and check out our library. People can come to, we have socials about once a month. They can come to a dinner. And, you know, if you're not feeling great, or if you're undergoing chemo and your hair all fell out, going into public to a restaurant is a little bit of an adventure. You know, it may be something that you don't want to be in public with. All, you know, people go out sick all the time. We're hardy Midwesterners, and you know, I'm dragging myself everywhere. But if you're with somebody who's got an immune system that's compromised, you need to not do that. And people understand that at Gilded, so we're a very safe environment. I've worked there for 4 years, and I haven't been sick a day since I've been there. I used to work in a grade school, and I was sick all the time.
Yeah.
You know? So we're in a pretty germ-safe environment, which is really quite nice. Oops, sorry, wrong one. Come on. Okay. The people who do participate in our programs, whether they're people with cancer or their families and friends, they may reduce the cost of their medical care. You know, a lot of times, sometimes when you go into a psychologist, the stress that you're dealing with is not so immense that you can get a diagnosis. But it's real, and the stress is real, and the depression that people feel that comes from a cancer diagnosis is real, and it's not just, oh, it's just a hard time, go ahead. And, you know, it's super real. But the more you can feel like you have some control over some of the things that are going on with you, the more you can take on your life, and the more you'll feel in control of your treatment and be able to step into it a little bit more. So people, you know, often will see a lower cost of their medical care. There's fewer hospitalizations. The hospitalizations that people frequently have are shorter in duration. And a lot of people are, you know, they go back to work real soon. And a lot of people, you know, most of our members actually right now, I think I just did a little survey the other day, and I think about 75% of our folks are still working full-time, which is hard. It's hard to do. And the patient-active concept, which is taking some control over the things that you can't control, asking questions, being involved in your treatment. So if you don't understand something, ask the questions that you have until somebody gives you an answer that you understand. You might not like it, it might not be the answer you're looking for, but it's really important to understand it, because if we don't understand what's happening to us, we don't understand how to process some of the side effects, you know, or is understanding if the feeling that you have if you're sick to your stomach, is that because you ate something bad, because you're getting the flu, or is that a side effect of your treatment? And if it's a side effect of your treatment, is there something that they can do to help reduce that? Because the drugs that are out there to help with things like nausea and stuff, and we don't do any medical stuff, but the stuff that's out there right now is way better than it was even 10 years ago. I went through treatment 10 years ago, and it was, you know, the stuff that's out there now is way, way better. And we do work, you know, what we do is not an alternative. And having to, you know, understanding what's going on, having some control over things, taking some, what I call agency, you know, like, all right, I'm going to actually do this, taking this on, isn't an alternative to treatment, it's a part of treatment. And it's, you know, it makes you a great partner to work with. As a, you know, the physicians that I work with who are working with patient-active patients are going, wow, this is fantastic, because you're a partner in your treatment. According to Harold Benjamin, who is the starter of the instigator of all of this stuff, you know, it's participation in your fight for recovery from cancer will improve your quality of your life and might even enhance the possibility of recovery. There's no guarantees, but you know, when you're dealing with a cancer diagnosis, you'll kind of take a, you know, if whatever's not going to hurt me, I'll do, because I want to get better, right? So all of our programs are evidence-based. We don't do any, you know, wild things, but you know, they also are things that aren't necessarily all medical. There's this part of of medicine that's called psychoneuroimmunology. The word itself is like this long. But it's psycho, brain, neuro, like your immune system, and immunology, or neuro being your thoughts, and immunology being how your immune system works, right? The science of that. So, as you know, there's some people talk about positive thinking. And we are about positive thinking, we are about hope, we are about laughter, but we are not about not honoring the fact that there's fear, there's anger. That's all real too. But if you can, you know, what we do is we study how those things all impact everything. And some of the things that are coming, you know, that are being found in these studies is people who are in support groups, who are learning about their disease, learning about how they can, what they can do for themselves. Educational programs, some of our online programs, we do have, we've got things that people can call in and talk to a to a counselor on the phone. I was going to bring you one of our flyers on that too, because I bet we could just put that somewhere, you know, that card, phone number.
Mail it,
or one of our staff members lives real close by. So.
Okay.
We'll get that to you. Or people can do support groups online. You know, a lot of folks that are in very rural areas, it's really hard to get to a support group. And we hear that all the time from people, you know. But I live in, you know. If that's how it feels. You know, I live in Lancaster. How am I supposed to get to a support group in Verona or in Middleton at 6 o'clock at night? That's just not gonna work.
Yeah.
So here are some other options for you. But people do, you know, if you've got the support, you can feel like you can handle it, right? So the things that we're finding out about, you know, some of our outcomes. Almost 87% of people have experienced reduced stress. A lot of them are reducing their loneliness. A lot of them, more than 90% are getting information. We're an information-seeking culture. You know, tell me what to do, tell me how to do it. Almost 90% are getting social support in our, you know, whether it's in a knitting class or in a support group. A lot of people are making new friends. We've got this whole crew of women that they initially met in a support group, they're all done with their treatment, they're out of their support group. Some of them did one of our classes called Transitions, which is a 6-week class for people after treatment has ended. They're meeting now to exercise, they're doing potlucks of healthy food, they're doing art projects together, they're getting together and playing Bunko, which is a game I do not understand, but they say it's really fun. And almost 80% have experienced a raise in their level of just hope in general.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't cost them anything. You know, that's like, wow, that's a gift that you can really give to the world, right? So what do we really do? Like I was saying, I talked a lot about our support groups. We have, currently we have two different times that we have support groups, on Tuesday evenings and on Thursday mornings. Our Tuesday evening group is what we call our family night. We have four adult support groups that meet at the same time, about 50 people in those. We have a kids group of 5 to 12 year olds. We have a teen group, and we have childcare for kids that are under 5. Also on Tuesday nights, because imagine trying to get your family wrangled, home from work, wrangle the family, feed them dinner, get them to group by 6 o'clock. You're like, that's not really reasonable. So at 5:30, we have some wonderful volunteers who come and make dinner for us. So we have dinner once a week for people in the support group to help them, help facilitate that. Okay, we're gonna come in, eat dinner. I mean, it's kind of like a school lunch, you know, it's 30 minutes. you get there at 5:30, group starts at 6, you know. But it's, you know, healthy, quick dinner, people are happy to have it. We've filled the dining room with families, and we've got kids, you know, sort of the unofficial kids table where we always have a couple of parents who volunteer to be there or who are invited. It's really quite an honor to be invited to sit at the kids table. So, and then on Thursday mornings, we also have a group that meets at 10. And that's people who are survivors or people who currently have a cancer diagnosis, and another group for family and friends. That's our supporters group that we call it. That group tends to be a little bit older, a lot of folks who are retired. They don't have like a meal officially attached to it, but we do have frequently, maybe 3 or 4 times a year, we'll have a lunch and learn right afterwards where people will bring a sandwich and we'll make soup, and everybody's thrilled. Tomorrow we're doing a thing on getting your affairs in order. And it is open to the public in case you're interested in coming and making the trip to Middleton. And we've got, I think, 30 people registered for it. So it's a, you know, our workshops can be pretty great. Our networking groups and support groups, our networking groups are monthly groups. They are typically, all of our support groups are facilitated by mental health professionals. And our monthly groups are either a specific kind of cancer or people in a particular group of some sort. For instance, we have a group called Moving Forward for people after they've completed treatment. We've got a young survivors networking group for young adults 18 to 40 who've had a diagnosis. We have a breast cancer group, a metastatic breast cancer group, because that's, you know, that's a whole different story. A lot of women with metastatic breast cancer, not here, but in other places in the country, have actually been told that they really can't come to a regular cancer group because they would be such a bummer for everybody else. We do not abide by that at all. I think that's a horrible thing to say to somebody. Yeah. And you know, and one of the things that we all learn is we are all there for each other. And it doesn't matter where you are in your cancer journey. But we do have a metastatic breast cancer group that meets once a month. It's wonderful. And those women really are quite the support crew for each other. We've got a blood cancer group, lots of information with that. A lung cancer group. We don't have a brain cancer group. The brain cancer group is, well, and the reason is there's one down on, there's one at the hospital.
Yeah.
And the cancer community is still pretty small. We do the things that nobody else is doing. I mean,
okay.
Breast cancer?
Hospital?
It's a UW,
okay.
Yeah. But it's open to anyone with, you know, from any system.
Sure.
The difference with breast cancer, and initially we weren't going to do a breast cancer group because there are so many in the community.
So many.
But people said, our members were like, no, you need to have a breast cancer networking group. Okay. You know, you can't really argue with 70 ladies who are sitting there saying, look, I'm coming here for support, and this is where I want it. So. We're a little bit different than all of the other support groups, breast cancer groups, and so yeah, that's what we do. Most of our other things are groups that aren't in other areas. There's you know, or at the time. So yeah, I mean, it would be great to have a brain cancer group, but we just don't find that high of a need for it. People generally will frequently fit themselves into another demographic. Like we've got a lot of. Several people with brain cancer in our young survivors group.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, their issue really is more, I'm dealing with the fact that I'm 30 and have little kids and dealing with this than the fact that it's a brain cancer diagnosis.
Yeah.
So people really choose the thing that's important to them.
Right.
We do have a men's group as well, and our men's group is for any man with any diagnosis, as well as if they are supporters of someone. And it's a group that just is really, they're really phenomenal. Their diagnoses are very, it's very widely varied. And they just do a great job of supporting each other in their very guy-like fashion. I love them. And this is how things have happened in the last 4 years for us. When we keep growing every year, this is our total support group attendance in the last 4 years. So we started at almost 2,500 in the first year that we opened. We're now up to just over 4,000. Different visits for support groups, not individuals, but people coming in for touches. So that's pretty cool. We also are doing a lot of lectures and workshops and things like that. Information is important. Information is power. And so a lot of our information is coming from physicians, it's coming from professionals in the community, it's coming from people who really know their stuff. We do a lot of focusing on self-care kinds of things, the things that you can do, right? You keep hearing that from me, right? I'm kind of a broken record about do what you can. We have professional volunteers. We've got a series of lectures that we do occasionally that's based on some research that's been done by our national organization. They give us the slides for things, and we find physicians who will be doing things. In February, we have two, frankly speaking, lectures coming up. One of them is for people with lung cancer, and the other is on colorectal cancer. The end of February, end of February is the colorectal cancer one. And I did bring some calendars so you can sort of take a look at what's going on. And then cancer transitions is also that class that I talked about, the 6 week long class for people after they've completed treatment. And it can be any kind of cancer. And our workshop series, we frequently will have different workshop series that will be between 1 and 8 sessions long. And one of the series that we're doing right now is a grief and loss series, 5 weeks long. We just started it last week on the seasons of grief, and really giving people an opportunity to think about and talk about, what is this whole grief thing all about, and how do I want to approach it, and helping people to also understand that, just because you don't have to go to a grief group to properly process your grief. And we're doing a lot of cooking, and there's a huge amount of information or of curiosity about food and how it can make me feel better. If we go way back to Plato, he was like, let food be your medicine and medicine be your food. I'm like, oh, well, that kind of makes some sense, doesn't it? Talk about old school. We also do social events. Our social events range from potluck dinners. We're doing a potluck dinner and a bingo night, game nights, comedies. We've had dancing groups come in. We do every year our anniversary party, which is actually, I think, really fun. The entertainment for our anniversary party is us. And we do not individually, but the community provides the entertainment. It's, we call it Gilda's Got Talent, and people sing, they dance, they share their poetry. We've had people do martial arts routines. We've had people show off some of their art. I mean, it's really very neat and very, very community-based. People are like, it's different. It feels different here than it feels at my church or at my school or whatever, because it's such a diverse group of people. And they all come together and they all support each other. And we all celebrate life, because even in the midst of cancer and all the difficult things that are going on, you gotta live life while you got it. We have a youth program. Noogieland is our kids group space that we call it. We do programs for kids from 3 to 18. We do special social events for them. We have childcare for our parents. If it were not for the wonderful volunteers who come and do childcare for us, most of them are university students. If it wasn't for them, a lot of our parents wouldn't be able to get to support groups. And so we are so grateful for our volunteers and the folks that help us with childcare. We do things, specifying, making age-appropriate opportunities for people, and then we've got a teen room which doubles when the teens aren't there as a game room, and we've got Wii and Wii Fit and things like that where members can come in and adult members can come in and utilize the equipment there for themselves, things like Wii bowling. So what are we? We are a community, and if you walk into our space, you'll see that, you'll feel that. If you walk into our space during an activity, lecture, workshop, a group, it's just sort of, it's one of those palpable things. You walk into some place, wow. We see people walk in all the time. Dean Oncology is about 3 blocks away from us, just on the other side of, what's that road? I don't know, it's about 3 blocks away. And people will come in right after a diagnosis and they'll come in like this. I don't know what's going on. In 5 minutes after talking, you'll see their shoulders go drop down, you see their faces relax, they might start breathing, actually, instead of actually breathing. They have an opportunity to recognize that they're not all alone, they'll get through this, however they need to get through it, and there are resources for them. And actually, one of the women who was just pictured a moment ago, one of the things she wrote to us once is that we were a life raft in the middle of a really stormy sea. And she could not imagine having to go through what she was going through without Gilda's Club there for herself and her family. She has since passed, and she died, and she was great. Cause she, who gets to sing at your own funeral, right? She sang at her own funeral. She was a singer. That's part of the community, where people can come together and they know it. We are a place where people live with cancer. Cancer is a part of their lives. It is not their whole life. A lot of folks say, what Gilda's Clubs give me is an opportunity to place cancer in a container. So when I leave here, I can go and live the rest of my life. And what a great opportunity to have play in some place where whatever is the big nasty thing in your life can be just sort of put in its place. And kind of like what some people talk about with facing fears, a lot of fears being sort of like a paper tiger. It looks scary, but if you turn around and poke it, it's just a piece of paper. So a lot of what we do is give people an opportunity to turn around and face it and go, okay, I can put this here. It's still coming up. It's still a part of my life, but I can recognize that it is something that I can still live with. People are real. They can be themselves. They can be angry. They can be sad. They can be happy. They can be thrilled. They can be scared. They can be walking around going, wow, I've got a scan tomorrow and I don't know what it's going to say and I'm scared about it. And people will go, okay, where can you put that fear? What can you do with it? Or maybe that's really, let me know how it goes. I'm here for you, whatever you need. And then really that celebrating that full range of emotions, the camaraderie, the laughter that comes when people are just together is important. It's healing. It's part of, even if the cancer takes over your body, it's still, the rest of you is still here. And even in the very ending days, you are still more you than you are cancer.
So hanging on to you for as long as possible.
That's a good way to put it.
So how do people find us? They find us picking up calendars in their waiting room. We're trying to be in most waiting rooms. That's a little bit tough sometimes, but we're working on it. A lot of times physicians will direct refer. We've had one of our members, she was taken down to the health psychologist. The health psychologist says, you know what you need? You need to go to Gilda's Club. Because I'm happy to work with you, but I can't do this by myself. So you need to go to Gilda's Club. Yes! Take her cookies. Referrals by other members. We've had, you know, we have all the time people come to us and say, so how'd you hear about us? Well, I was in the waiting room, and I was talking, you know, this person was sitting next to me, and I was talking to them, and they said, so have you been to Gilda's Club yet? No, what's that? Well, let me tell you. They're our best people, because they're saying, this is what it's all about, this is what I do, I go to this group, and I've been to this kind of a class, and did you know that they do this? And did you know that you can learn how, blah, blah, and like, and way better than anything that we can do. Just everything. And then we do have a fair amount, you know, a small amount of publicity that we do, talks like this, some of our, we will do press releases and things like that, but not as much as a lot of folks. As I said earlier, we are free service for people, and we are not supported by government money, we are not supported by insurance money, we are not supported by a drug company. We are supported by individual gifts, by foundations and grants. We do occasionally put in a grant to one of the pharmaceuticals to do an education program. We're supported by our special events, our memorials and bequests, and we are super supported by our volunteers. We as a staff number, including our part-time staff, we number 10 people. We have 1,400 or 1,000 visits every year in our space. We serve 50 weeks of dinner. it's amazing the amount of stuff that we do every year. And our volunteers are incredible. You know, 2,500 members, 10 staff, meet in the middle a little bit with the volunteers. We have about 250 volunteers who help us out with a lot of different things, everything from cooking those meals to stuffing envelopes to being the person who sits at the front desk and greets people when they come in, helping us with, you know, administrative stuff. We're really, you know, our community feel goes beyond just members and beyond just staff. The community includes our volunteers and supporters. So that's pretty much Gilda's Club. This is our front door. Pointing at this, it's like, this is our front door. These are some of the folks at some of our social activities and our evening stuff. So I do thank you for your time. Do you have questions or comments?
That's very good. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit more about Gilda Radner? Her life? Just a little bit.
Okay. Yeah. Well, Gilda, that's a hard question.
Yeah.
Because my job is really the support thing and not really a Gilda Radner historian.
Yeah.
However, Gilda was 40. She was on the very first cast of Saturday Night Live.
Yeah.
Back in, was it 75?
Wow.
Look at, we got an extra actor.
Yeah,
actor.
I used to
In 75. She was fantastic. She was hilarious.
Just really.
You know, the other thing that we do sometimes is we have this great CD of the best of Gilda.
Okay.
And we'll put that on during some of our activities. But we had it on during one of our socials not too long ago. And one of our 10-year-olds, there were some kind of greasy bits in there. I'm like, And I'm saying they're getting kind of embarrassed, and his mom and grandma are like, oh, yeah, well, you know, he watches TV. Like, wow, okay.
Yeah, no, I don't know.
it was pretty funny. But she was very funny. She was madly in love with her husband, Gene Wilder.
Gene Wilder, man.
Who's a Milwaukee boy. And did you know that?
I did not
know. Yeah. And just, you know, she was just a magical lady.
You know, anybody in theater, you would know her. In theater.
Yeah,
very good. My twin sister was a theater major.
Mm-hmm.
She used to reenact her. You know, she used to do her,
mm-hmm.
and she was so good. Because she had her hair all, you know, frizzy.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
My God.
Our, the guy that does our PA stuff all the time, our audio guy, who's in town here, his name is Jeffrey Sandler, and his mother was one of Gilda's customers.
Ah.
And she came in, she was in town last year, and Heyman talked about her a little bit. You know, and she was just, she's very, very sweet, very kind, a little bit insecure.
Yeah.
Is she, she actually started the club first? Or
no, the club actually was started after she died. It was Gene Wilder and Jean Shalit, does that name ring a bell? And Joanna Bull, her psychologist. They kind of put, and some of their other friends were the ones who created the Gilda's Club in New York.
Yeah.
So it was just like, you know, we really need, she recognized how important the support was, and they recognized how important the support was. And they're like, no, we need to make this happen.
Yeah.
You know, because in New York, the culture there is that everybody kind of has their own therapist, right? I mean, it's kind of, just sort of, that's the culture. You've got your own therapist. But in that one-on-one relationship, it's a different kind of relationship than being in a group with other people who, as everybody who I know says, you know, people here get it. I don't have to explain. I don't have to translate. We just get it. We get it when somebody walks in and says, you know, I'm just kind of feeling like the horse ran over me.
Yeah.
You know, and we understand that. We understand.
Yeah.
And so it's like, okay, so, you know, what are the things that you can, that help you feel a little less like the horse ran over you? Attend to those. Or just say, yeah, this is hard.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes the folks who even in what people say is that, you know, members tell us is that even the health psychologists and the oncologists, and sometimes they don't really, they get it less than people at Gilda's do. And depression is a huge piece that, you know, they're kind of, people are saying, you know, I just was doing some research and they're saying, yeah, about 30% of people who are diagnosed experience depression, but my experience has been way higher than that, and it's very underdiagnosed. And there are many, many things that can be done to deal with depression and to manage it that are not pharmaceutical, that are things that improve your quality of life overall. Taking a walk, eating good food, talking to people who you trust.
Yeah.
All of those things help reduce depression. What do we do at Gilda's Club? We have yoga classes and cooking classes and support groups and
it's all part of living.
It is all part of living,
you know,
and anything that you do, right? It's all part of living, and it kind of wraps all together.
Things that in times in our lives that are so bad that we do almost fall into a depression.
Mm-hmm. And there's clinical depression, which is isn't just being sad. It's this long list of things. And, you know, for people to recognize it and to do something about it, because it can impact your immune system and it can impact how you process everything.
Right.
I'm not a doctor, I'm a counselor. So, but I'm a counselor who also really believes in the power of what can I do.
I was one of those patients that was a little bit on the feisty side. And my doctors all appreciated it, and I appreciated it, because it made me feel like I was doing something.
Yeah.
So, and Gilda's, you know, Gilda's treatment was really hard, her cancer was really challenging, and she did die way too young. And unfortunately, ovarian cancer is one of those cancers that frequently is diagnosed far later than it ought to be, because there's very few symptoms of it. So, she's missed.
How many Gilda's clubs are there? Is it just the two? Or how many,
there? Okay, so that's a challenging question because of the umbrella, the new umbrella,
okay.
Right? The cancer support community umbrella.
Okay.
There are 22 Gilda's clubs. They're still called Gilda's clubs.
Sure.
Across the world.
Okay.
There are 27 cancer support communities.
Okay.
But when you combine them under the big umbrella, there are 50-something standalone communities that are doing programming, in about 100 different sites, because a lot of our folks are doing programs in hospitals and things like that.
The umbrella that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
is that I've had when we said that we were setting up something with Gilda's Club, somebody said, are they changing their name?
They changing their name,
is there something with that? Is that what you're talking
yeah,
about?
Yeah. So it's a little complicated because we're kind of in the middle of, we were planning on changing our name to the Cancer Support Community,
mm-hmm.
And started making some steps towards that, and in November kind of came out saying, hey, this is what we're planning. And we got a lot of feedback. And so what we are doing now is trying to keep our name,
okay.
because, even if we do end up changing the name of the club, the spirit is still there, our program is still, really intact, and
mm-hmm.
so.
Sure.
Okay.
I hope you don't change it, but then again, I understand, because I'm running into people, like we're saying, that don't even know him, but
mm-hmm.
I was talking to him, and he was born in the same room I was.
Yeah.
And she's probably about the same, or was probably about the same.
Mm-hmm.
So,
she, The challenge is that a lot of people when they're Gilda's Club and really don't know what we do. They don't know that we are a cancer support organization for anyone with any cancer at any age and their families.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Right?
That's a lot.
Right. Yeah.
And
almost anybody fits into there, someone.
Yeah.
If you don't have cancer yourself, you know somebody that does.
Right, right. And it's really for the primary support people, but
Remember back when we were small, cancer was just cancer, and it died from it. That's all I remember. They didn't talk about this kind of cancer, that kind of cancer. And now there's so many kinds, cancer of everything,
mm-hmm.
Cancer of your, but there's cancers of everything. With
right.
brain cancers, my God, there are so many different kinds.
Right, even within, within any of the individual, cancer is sort of this umbrella term,
right.
that is,
it is
any group of cells that are sort of gone wild.
Wild.
And if you think about it, cancer cells really aren't very smart, because their eventual thing that they do is they take over the body that is in them, and then it dies, and so do they.
Mm-hmm.
So, and what we're, what the medical community is trying to do is, okay, so let's keep the person alive and get rid of the cancer. And I'm kind of a fan of that.
Yeah.
That and raising awareness.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
As she was saying, years ago, it was just a death
mm-hmm.
sentence.
Right,
yeah.
It was a death
sentence.
It was very
scary.
And people
talk
about, did you hear about about the lady cancer. My grandma had cancer.
Yeah.
You can never talk about it. And how terrifying is that? Because if you don't talk, if the things we don't talk about take on their own lives. And sometimes they're a lot scarier in our imaginations than they are in reality. And sometimes they're not. But, you know, the treatment has gotten so much better. And they're doing so much. And
it's amazing what's happened in life.
Yeah. And recognizing the, you know, the psychological power that we all have is also
important.
And
people will always remember the, like, you had cancer. How are you? Are you okay? And, you know.
There's a difference with people, you know, the before cancer, how you doing, and the after cancer, so how are you? Great!
<Okay. laughs> Yeah, I know.
And yeah, so thank you so much for your time.